creatures of our God and King. And every mountain, every valley, everything. Oh, and every good word, every song we could sing. You make everything. You make everything beautiful.
Good morning, North Point, and good to see you this morning. This is it for our beauty series. We've been 10 weeks talking about beauty and the arts, and after today, you never have to think about beauty again, all right? No, I hope that you will. I hope you've learned some things in this series. I hope you've seen God, His beauty, and the desire He has for you to cultivate beauty. I hope maybe it's intrigued you a little bit to say, hey, I gotta learn more about that. I gotta look at that a little more. I gotta take some more time for that. I need to develop this thing a little bit more. I know that for some of you, like after this series, you're still never gonna go to the opera, you know, or you're never gonna sit at home in your cigar chair sipping tea, you know, and listening to Bach. And that's okay. That's all right if you don't do that. But I hope that you have come to see that God, this creative God, made you in His image. He put inside you a longing and a desire for beauty. That comes from Him, and it points you back to Him, and He has given you an ability to create, to design, to organize in some way, and I hope you'll take some time to investigate that, to look into that a little bit more. Now, Jay helped us to see our beautiful God last week, and he did a great job with that. And I want to tell you what we're going to do after this series, since today is our last beauty message, is we're going to do a series called Simply Jesus. And I just figured coming off of a beauty series, we might as well talk about the most beautiful thing in the world for a little while, okay? So that's what we're going to do for the rest of the year, talking about Jesus. I mean, we do that every Sunday, I hope, but in a special way, all right, for the rest of the year. And this series is actually going to lead us up to Christmas, which, if you can believe it, we're really not that far away from Christmas. Let's have an honest moment here. How many of you have listened to Christmas music yet this year? How many have done it? Look at you, crazy people. Like, you have already, a few of you. You know, yesterday I actually got up on the roof. Lots of, like, fall cleaning stuff was going on. Clean the garage, the yard, the landscape, you know, some of that. And then since Michelle was out of town with her oldest daughter, Alexis, doing a college visit, the rest of us got up on the roof of the house. And we only do that when Mom's gone, right, because she can't stand that. But the three younger girls and myself, we get up on the roof and we put up our Christmas lights yesterday. Because, I don't know if you're like me, I always wait too long and it's freezing cold. I'm like, no, this is like 70 degrees outside, I'm putting them up, so I didn't turn them on yet, but like we'll do that. We got to wait at least till Halloween's over, right, to do that. So anyways, okay, enough of that. One other thing, though, that I want to tell you about this beauty series that I hope this has done for some of you, and there's a particular subset of people that I hope this series has really encouraged, and that are the true artists. You know, where you've known that you're an artist, and that thing has just been inside of you, but you've never really heard your church talk about that, and you've never really come to see how much God values this thing that He's put inside of you. I think about our artists, especially that are young people. We live in a culture today where I think a lot of times, like if you're in school and you don't play sports or really care that much about sports, and you're not into like kicking touchdowns or, you know, scoring baskets or I don't know, whatever. Like you mess that stuff up. You don't know about that, or you're not into the one form of art that is big, like music. You're not in a show choir or a school choir or something like that, but you like to draw. You like to paint. You like drama. You like to design things in that way. I hope that you've heard in this series that God put that desire inside of you. He wants you to cultivate it. He wants to grow it inside of you. I hope you know that He values you, and He wants to help you continue to flourish in that thing because it expresses His beauty, and it helps to point people to Him. And I hope that you'll see that value, that your church values you as well. So keep going with that, all of our young artists and old artists alike. Today, I have a really fun example of this for you to show you how this can work. Ian Halstead is a guy that's been involved in our tech ministry here at North Point. He currently is a student at Iowa State University studying computer science. And at some point in the midst of this series or preparing for this series, we got wind of the fact that Ian likes to create video games. And so we had the idea, what if Ian made a NorthPoint video game? Would he want to do that? And so throughout this semester, he has been working on the NorthPoint video game. And in the final Sunday of our series here on beauty, we're going to unveil it to you. So you want to check out the game? Okay, here's the game. Throw it. All right, there it is. All right, so it's called Beautiful. He made it off of this series. And the story of this is that Jeremy comes to church on Sunday morning and the NorthPoint logo is missing. It's in two halves, and you have to go through two different levels to get a half of the logo to put it back together and bring order and harmony back to NorthPoint, okay? So as you notice, it's like an 8-bit video game in 2D. It's like Mario Brothers, all right? And so you play the game, and then you get to the end. He's about to get the first half of the logo that is spinning up there. Play the music. Go a little bit louder, Dathan, with the music. Oh, there it is. Yeah. Yeah, you got it? Do you remember back to your childhood? Some of you, that's what this feels like. If you notice, it's the theme music for the Beautiful series. So one level is you're in cornfields. The other level, you're at the Iowa State Fair. Okay? So here's the deal. You can play this video game. We're making it available to you, but you can only play it on your computer. You can't play it on your phone. So that we didn't want people during the service playing this video game and then yelling out, dang it, I just died. You know, we didn't want any outbursts. So after the service, you can go onto the website. There's a link for it at the bottom. You can click it. We'll put it in the e-news as well. And I'm pretty sure as you guys get into this, it's going to overtake Fortnite as the top video game of 2022. I'm pretty sure about that. But anyways, that's awesome. So like, here's the deal. That's just a simple way to express the creativity, right, that God has put inside of you. But also, we have an opportunity through these creative things that God has put inside of us to attract people towards him. And that's what we want to talk about to finish up our series today. How beauty attracts us to God and how it can attract others to him as well. I think you know intuitively that beauty attracts, right? You know this. I want you to think about the very first time, if you can remember this, the first time that you noticed physical beauty and physical beauty caused an attraction inside of you. For me, I think it was in first grade, and her name was Eve. And I just remember Eve, and I really liked Eve, and I thought she was pretty. And so, in fact, one time Eve was standing in line in our classroom when I'm in first grade, and I walked past her quickly, and I kissed her on the cheek. Unfortunately, Eve wasn't feeling it like I was feeling it at that moment, and so she broke up with me, and we weren't boyfriend and girlfriend anymore, and we couldn't go out anymore. I don't know where we were going in the first place, but we weren't going there anymore. After that happened. But I can remember that, like, she's pretty, and I was attracted to her. And you probably had a similar experience, something like that. I mean, maybe you weren't kissing girls in first grade, you know, but that desire, that attraction that is in there. I think you get this. Physical beauty catches our attention. The smell and the look of a favorite food. A certain song, when that plays, it draws you in. A place in nature that you like to go. Even a well-organized closet for some of you. Like, we've talked about this throughout this series. Sometimes those grass lines in your yard, or, you know, winter is coming, and soon our driveways are going to be covered with snow. And some of you, you pray that the snow will come because you've got one of those snow blowers with the hand warmers on it, right? And it probably plays music and almost drives by itself. But, like, you go out and you can't wait to make your driveway look perfect. The way that you shoot the snow, the way that it gets just little lines that are on there, you actually don't even want anybody to drive on it after you snowblow your driveway, because you look at it and you're like, yes, this thing is beautiful. It pulls you in, it draws you in, and you enjoy it. Now, we've seen this throughout the scriptures, but we've seen this especially in Psalm 19. And since we've looked here before, I'm going to give it to you in the Message version. Listen to what this says. God's glory is on tour in the skies. Godcraft on exhibit across the horizon. In other words, God's beauty is being displayed to us in all of nature. And then he says this, Madam Day holds classes every morning. Professor Knight lectures each evening. Their words aren't heard. Their voices aren't recorded, but their silence fills the earth. Unspoken truth is spoken everywhere. In other words, God's beauty in nature, it reveals him. And as it reveals him and we see it, it draws us to him to want to know more, to lean into that thing, to find out more about it. Paul says a very similar thing to us in Romans chapter 1. So if you've got a Bible, take it and turn to Romans 1 this morning, page 911 in the chair Bibles there. Now, the context in Romans chapter 1 is kind of a negative context that Paul is talking about. What he's saying here in Romans chapter 1 is about people who suppress God's truth and rebel against God. Like Adam and Eve said, no, we're going to take the fruit from the one tree you told us not to eat from, and we're going to say no to you, God. Paul is saying that people, humanity in general, have done this. They've said no to God, they've denied, they've suppressed the truth that God has given to them, and therefore, there's consequences for their actions, separation from God, and they're without an excuse. Nobody has an excuse for rejecting God. Why don't they have an excuse? Well, notice what he says in Romans 1, verse 19. It says, since what may be known about God, it's plain to them because God has made it plain to them. That is, God has revealed something to humanity so that they don't have an excuse because he said, I'm here and I exist. Well, what is that thing God has done for every single human being that should know that he exists? Verse 20. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power, his divine nature, they've been clearly seen. How have they been seen? How do you see the quality and the character of God? They're understood from what has been made so that people are without an excuse. In other words, nature shows us something about God. It shows us something about his divine power, his ability, the nature of who he is. It shows us the glory of God and the beauty of God. And in that, there is in every single person then a natural attraction to find out who's responsible for these things. Like, who came up with the stars? Who came up with the intricacy of this universe? Who came up with the giraffe, right? Who came up with the rose, how it unfolds, petal after petal? Who came up with that design? Now, Paul says this. Some people just say, forget about it. Don't worry about it. Probably just happened. Probably isn't really a God there, or it's not something I really want to think about. I don't think God exists, or I don't know if God exists, and I don't want to spend time on it. In other words, like Paul says, they suppress the truth. They say no to the truth that they see. But others see the beauty, and they search for the source of that beauty. They're drawn into it. That was Ian's story today from the video. Remember Ian's story? Isn't that so good? It's like I started a relationship with God. I think I'm going to do that, but then I'm out in nature, and when I see all the beauty in nature, it just says to me, God has to exist. God has to be real. Brad Smith, who is on staff here at North Point, he's our group's lead, and if you would talk to Brad about his story of coming to faith in Jesus, it's very much like this. He was in college, and he came to trust in Jesus, and about 3 months into his relationship with Jesus, he took a spring break trip with some people down to the Florida Keys. He got to go scuba diving in the Florida Keys, and he says, when I'm scuba diving and I start to see all of these fish in the colors and the beauty and the intricacy of this, I just said to myself, God is actually beautiful. I didn't yet know that God was beautiful, but my eyes were awakened to this. He actually goes back to college. He changes his major to marine biology because of seeing the beauty. Eventually switches that major to study bugs, of all things. And then he came up with a pest control company that kills bugs now. But but he learned from those bugs. And if you would talk to Brad, he would say this. It was the beauty of God that really drew me to him and showed me who he was. He says, you know, a lot of people, they talk about the stars and the heavens and the universe and this macro beauty of God. He said, for me, it was the micro beauty of God. That I could take an insect and put it under a microscope and see the intricacy and design of a leg of a bug. And I said to myself, God is unbelievable. He is beautiful. He's amazing. One more story of this. Philip Yancey, who some of you may know, you may have read his books. He's a prolific Christian author. He's written books like What's So Amazing About Grace and The Jesus I Never Knew. He recently came out with a memoir. And in the memoir, he talks about his sort of harsh religious upbringing that he had that caused him to be very cynical about God and to have a very one-sided view of the nature of God. He describes God like this. He says, I saw God as an arm twister, a cosmic bully who schemes to break anybody who dares to resist him. Have you ever had that view of God? Or know people do? God's a judge. He's got a big stick up in heaven. He's ready to whack you and give you consequences whenever you step out of line. He says that was the basically only view of God that he had. But you know what drew Yancey back to God and back into faith? It was the beauty of God that did it. He talked about doing nighttime jogs outside under the stars. He talked about going to the planetarium or the sweet smell of honeysuckle, seeing a frog, a fawn, a blue heron. And he ends up saying this, nature awakens my desire to meet whoever is responsible for the monarch butterfly. It was beauty that drew him back in. It was beauty that began to show him who God truly is. And look, that's what beauty can do. Beauty can do this in a way that sometimes words can't. I think that's what Romans chapter 1 is saying. In nature, you're able to see, in a sense, without words, that God exists and that that God is beautiful and that he has something more to tell you and to show you. Now, we got to be careful here because you all know that nature alone can't save us. You can't come into a relationship with God just by looking up at the stars and hoping everything turns out okay. You're going to need Jesus in his life, his death, and his resurrection in order to have that relationship with God. But God's beauty and creation can awaken your desire to know him. That's what nature does. That's what the beauties do. They pull you into God's truth. It attracts you to him. It makes you want to find out more. Blaise Pascal, the famous mathematician, he lived in the 1600s, and like many scientists and mathematicians, the first ones at least, most of them, if not all of them, were Christians. So for Pascal, he was also a Catholic theologian and a philosopher. You may best know him if you can remember back to, or some of you are in it now, algebra for Pascal's triangle, right? This is that guy. And Pascal said this, "Every man is almost always led to believe not through proof, but through that which is attractive." Now look, proof is often needed, or at least it's a necessary step, because we need information. We need knowledge. We need to understand some things for sure. But knowledge alone usually doesn't seal the deal. And you know why knowledge alone doesn't seal the deal? It's because your heart needs to be moved. Because you need to feel it. You need to desire it. You need to want it. And beauty is the thing. The arts are the thing that often pulls your heart into it. Beauty makes you want it. So nature can help to lead you there. Music can help lead you there. Painting, a beautiful story, science, mathematics, architecture, bugs even apparently can do it for you. Any form of true beauty that leads you to the source, it pulls you in, moves your heart. You know, sometimes beauty is so powerful it betrays even those who don't want to believe in God. Even somebody that says, no, I'm an atheist, I'm an agnostic, I don't believe in God, I don't think he exists, I resist him. Sometimes beauty betrays them. As G.K. Chesterton said, the worst moment for the atheist is when they're really thankful and have no one to thank. Right? There's a sense of awe, a sense of wonder that can stir up in somebody like, I don't even know where I go to with this feeling that I have about this thing is amazing because I don't think God exists. Maybe he does. See, sometimes when even the atheist looks at beauty long enough, he stops resisting and allows himself to receive the truth. God does exist, and he is beauty. He is beauty. But that beauty is never fully known in nature. We got to be careful of this, right? The beauty itself, it's never fully known in nature or in science or in architecture or the arts. All those are wonderful expressions of God's beauty. But they're all meant to lead us to him. There is a pinnacle of beauty. There is a supreme form of beauty that is unlike any other. And for this, we turn to 1 John chapter 4. So if you got your Bible, flip over to 1 John chapter 4, page 988 in those chair Bibles. Notice John, who was writing this, what he says. 1 John 4, verse 7. He says, "Dear friends, let us love. Let us love one another. For love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever doesn't love, well, they don't know God, because God is love." Is anything more beautiful than love? Is there anything that attracts you more, draws you in more, changes you more than love? As humans, love is our greatest need in this life, to be known, to be accepted, to be loved. But not just told that you are loved, right? It's one thing that somebody says, "I love you," but somebody can say, "I love you" 100,000 times, and if they don't show it, it doesn't mean anything. Like, I could tell my wife, Michelle Hodney, "I love you, I love you, no, I love you." And she's gonna be like, "But could you clean your stuff up every once in a while, right? Could you take me out to dinner? Could you buy me flowers? Could you help take care of our family? Could you work a little harder as a father," right? She does. I'm not saying she says those things to me, but like, if I only ever said I loved her, but I never showed her that I loved her and that I cared about her and that I'm willing to give up some things for her, those words, the words, they don't mean anything. They actually mean the opposite, and they really become aggravating and hurtful to somebody if we don't back it up. Which makes the next verse, verse 9, so amazing. "This is how God showed his love. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. It's not that we loved God, but that he loved us. And he sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Look, nature shows us that God is big, that he is powerful, and that he is creative. But Jesus coming down as God to live and to die for us, to resurrect from the grave, shows us that God is love and that God's love is for us. Nature, music, science, and the arts, they're all amazing expressions of God's beauty. They draw us into God for sure, but Jesus is God's beauty. And in the most mind-bending, profound act in all of human history, that beauty, the supreme beauty of God, came down to this earth to give up his life so that we could know God in all of his beauty. And then that beauty, that love, changes us. Look at verse 11. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. Do you notice what John is saying there? He's saying to us, look, nobody has ever seen God. You haven't seen God, but you want to see what God is like? You want the best expression of God? Then look to his Son, Jesus Christ, who is love, and he's going to put that love inside of you when you receive his love and give you the ability to show people what God looks like by your love for each other. We've not seen God, but you've seen really close to what God looks like when we receive Jesus' love and we love others. Do you know that this is the thing that you need above all other things? Love that comes from God, love that is God. And when you receive that love of God, when you receive Jesus, it changes you. It transforms you. And it shows people who God is. Which, by the way, is why when you see a play, when you watch a movie, when you read a good novel, and within that story, the story centers around the sacrifice of the hero giving up himself, herself, or their life in order to save other people, you are moved by that. You might not be a crier, but that might bring a little tear to your eye, right? Because there's something inside of you that says, this is the true story. This is true love. This is what beauty really looks like, that kind of giving, that kind of sacrifice. Why does that do that in you? Why are those the best stories that we have? Because it echoes the one true story. It shows us the one true God who came down for us to give his life for us and to show us what true love is. Jesus is who all of these beauties are drawing us to see him, to know him, to experience his love, and to live in his grace. Now look, I can tell you all of that, and I have told you that, and I've given you this message this morning, we could have you read books about that. We could send you through classes on that. I could have you sign a contract paper that says that you cognitively understand the beauty of God and the love of God and what God has done. We could do all of those things for you. But you know something. You really need something else to help you not only know it, but feel it and allow it to transform your actions, the way that you live your life. And you know the thing that you and I need in order to make this thing, these truths, get into our hearts and change our lives? You know what you need? You need Ian's story, right? And you need music. You need songs to help it move to your heart. And you need images and graphics, and you need the paintings that are out in the foyer, and you need the cross in the background that always guides your eye towards Jesus. In other words, you need art. You need art to help us feel it and get it and understand it. I mean, even this message I'm giving to you, it's not simply words, right? There's stories and there's illustrations and there's object lessons that are a part of it because it is art that moves your heart, that changes us and transforms us. Do you see why arts and the cultivation of beauty is so important? It's a primary means that God uses to draw us to himself. And I'm not sure anybody is really drawn to God without the arts. I'm not sure we ever really get it without some form of art to move our hearts. It's the art that's the method. That's the form that shows us truly who God is. And so all of these forms of art and beauty and your contribution to it with your gifts and your abilities have the potential to move people in a way that words, reason, and truth alone sometimes cannot do. beauty can change us deeply and profoundly. I think you see this. I want to give you an example of this. How many of you have seen the 2007 Pixar film Ratatouille? Have you seen Ratatouille? Okay, if you haven't, you're about to see some of it today. But you maybe know this story. It's the story of this rat, right, who actually is personified so he can speak and he can talk, who loves cooking and is actually a pretty good chef. He just longs for and has this desire to be a chef, but there's a problem. He's a rat, right? And so nobody wants rats cooking their food. Through a series of circumstances, he's able to become a secret chef in a well-known restaurant by forming a relationship with another guy named Linguini. And Linguini is like kind of the busboy garbage guy of the restaurant, but Remy ends up being inside of his chef's hat, pulling his hair to get Linguini to cook the recipes he needs to cook, and so he stays secretive. Well, there's a series of events that happens and takes place, and things are going pretty well. When they find out at the pinnacle of the story, the climax of the story, famed restaurant critic Anton Ego is going to come and visit the restaurant. And Ego is known to be a harsh, cynical, mean-spirited critic, right? In fact, Ego was indirectly responsible for the previous restaurant owner's death, Chef Gusteau, right? And so this guy is just known to be brutal with his reviews. And so he comes into the restaurant, they get ready to serve Ego, and I want you to notice that in an instant, Ego's heart, his cynicism, his attitude is changed. What is it that changes him? Let's check out the video.
Ratatouille? They must be joking.
The following day, his review appears.
In many ways, the work of a critic is easy. We risk very little, yet enjoy a position over those who offer up their work and themselves to our judgment. We thrive on negative criticism, which is fun to write and to read. But the bitter truth we critics must face is that in the grand scheme of things, the average piece of junk is probably more meaningful than our criticism designating it so. But there are times when a critic truly risks something, and that is in the discovery and defense of the new. The world is often unkind to new talent, new creations. The new needs friends. Last night I experienced something new, an extraordinary meal from a singularly unexpected source. To say that both the meal and its maker have challenged my preconceptions about fine cooking is a gross understatement. They have rocked me to my core. In the past, I have made no secret of my disdain for Chef Gusteau's famous motto, "Anyone can cook," but I realize only now do I truly understand what he meant. Not everyone can become a great artist, but a great artist can come from anywhere. It is difficult to imagine more humble origins than those of the genius now cooking at Gusteau's, who is, in this critic's opinion, nothing less than the finest chef in France. I will be returning to Gusteau's soon, hungry for more.
So look, beauty. In this case, culinary beauty. Food turned a harsh critic into an admirer. Look, this is the opportunity, I think, that God's given to you and I. An opportunity to take the skills and the abilities and the creativity that he has placed inside of us because he's put his image inside of us. Not so much to draw attention to our skills and our ability and our creativity, but to lead people to Jesus, to change them, to transform them through the arts. A Japanese artist by the name of Makoto Fujimura said it this way: the arts are a cup that will carry the water of life to the thirsty. The arts are a cup that carries the water of life, Jesus' life, to those who are thirsty. And so maybe today we can think of ourselves as photographers. Photographers. I know that some of you, you like photography. You like to take pictures. In fact, with the invention of the smartphone, most of us think that we are photographers and we snap pictures all the time. Some of you are better at it than others, right? Some of you are a little bit more like me. Whenever we get the family together, Michelle and I are together, she's like, take a selfie. You have a longer arm. You got to hold the camera. And apparently it makes you look better if you're not holding it. I don't know. So we hold this thing out right, and then I click the down button and it turns the phone off. So that's my typical thing that I do. Oh, you turned it off again. We got to redo this. But today, this afternoon, my family is actually going to do family pictures, okay? And all of the husbands in here said, right? It's like we could go stand in line at the license branch or get family pictures. What do you want to do? I don't know. It's a toss-up for me. No. But I do like the memories that the pictures creates and what that does. I want you to think about the photographer. Because many of you, you got to get headshots for business. You're going to get senior pictures. You're going to get family pictures. Think about the role of the photographer in this when they're taking pictures. The photographer is there to capture you, to capture your beauty, to show your personality, to show who you are. The photographer isn't in the pictures, right? That would be really weird if you come back with your family pictures and your photographer is in the picture and you show that to other people and they're like, who is that random person in your pictures? Well, we just thought the photographer should be in it with us. What if she set the camera up and put it on a timer and then jump in with you? No, she's supposed to be capturing your beauty. She's supposed to be showing you, right? The photographer's not in the photo. And not only is she trying to capture your beauty and who you are, but she's not really creating beauty. She's not making you beautiful, right? If you're not beautiful, there's only so much she can do with it, right? Maybe some mad Photoshop skills might help a little bit. But she's just capturing what you are. And that's our role. We're doing the same thing with the beauties of God. We're all photographers, displaying the beauty of the most beautiful being in the universe, God himself. But we're not just doing that through actual photography. You're doing that through music and through painting and through organizing and through creating and through designing, through building. We're just displaying God's beauty through us, through the arts, which means you have a contribution. You are made in the image of God. You long for beauty. You have the ability to cultivate beauty. That beauty attracts both you and others to God. So be the photographer of God's beauty he created you to be. Northpoint, let's get after it. Let's value beauty and the arts. Let's cultivate it, and let's make sure it's always leading us to Jesus. It will change people's lives. It'll change people's lives. I want to finish up our series with Psalm 150. And you maybe have read Psalm 150 before. We've seen it in this series one other time. You can turn if you want, or you can just listen to the words. After 150 songs of reflection on the human condition, real, genuine life experiences in humanity, real emotions that are expressed towards God for help, for guidance, for direction, for mercy, and praise to God. This entire songbook, our songbook, it ends this way in Psalm 150. We're told this: praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary, in this space, and praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him outside as well. Praise him for his acts of power and praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise him with the harp and lyre. Praise him with timbrel and with dancing. Praise him with the strings and pipe. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with the resounding cymbals. Find any instrument you can to praise God and pluck it and strum it and bang on it so that God will be praised. Use everything you can to praise him. And then it ends with this: let everything that has breath praise the Lord. You praise the Lord. Do you realize what God is saying to you and I in Psalm 150? He's giving a command. This is not God asking you if you want to do it. It's a direct command. It is direct, it is focused, and he is saying to you today, you must praise me. It's strong from him. Have you ever wondered, why is it that God commands us to praise him? Why does he command you to give him this kind of praise with everything you've got? Why does he do that? It can't be because he needs it. I mean, God had all the praise and the glory and the joy in heaven before he ever created anything on this earth. He doesn't need it from us. He doesn't gain any more glory or praise from the fact that you actually praise him. He doesn't need any of that from you. Why then does God command you to praise him? You know why God commands you to praise him? Because he wants you to have the joy he has. Because he wants you to come in and to find the place of ultimate joy and ultimate satisfaction and ultimate goodness in his presence. And so when God commands you to praise him, it's as much of an invitation as it is a command. He's inviting you to see him. He's inviting you to know him. He's inviting you to have the joy and the happiness and the fulfillment that only he, the most beautiful being in all of the world, can give to you. So NorthPoint, let's take the invitation. Let's embrace our role as photographers of the beauty of God. Let's find our greatest joy in his beauty. And let's praise him with everything we've got. Would you pray with me?